In this video, we're going to unravel the cost of installing an EV charger.
Sit back and relax, I've got this one. Nice and easy, I went onto a thing called Google and I typed in how much will it cost to install a home EV charging point, and I've got it down to 449, I'm all in.
Oh well, very good guys, nice. Headline leading prices, was that an advert on page one of Google?
It was page one of Google. Is there a page two on Google? I only ever used the first page.
Well, no, not many people get to page two, where you're probably getting into the cost, the real cost of an EV charger. And we're going to explore that today, I think. Who was the one you found for that one?
I found PodPoint with that one, but it also takes into consideration the OZEV grant, which is sometimes called the OLEV grant, is the £350 added into that. So it's actually £799, yeah, yes. £800 all by a pound.
Yeah, and obviously that grant is available. It's not just through PodPoint. It's available on lots of different EV chargers if you meet certain criteria. But it's diminishing over time. It's £350 at the minute. It used to be £500, so that won't be around forever. So expect actually the real cost of chargers to increase over time. But we're going to help try and navigate our way through that. You know, we're not affiliated to PodPoint. We're just going to we'll explore their standard offer a little bit later. But first, let's explore the things you should think about to where that cost of an EV charger installation actually comes from. And what's the first thing we think about, Gary?
Well, I'm going to be concerned about what it looks like, probably, aren't I? So if I've paid £449 for it, I'm probably going to have no choice in which of the EV charging points they install. And it could be that I want to manage things like solar PV, and will the EV charging point be able to do that? I don't know, so I'm going to be stuck with the one that they arrive with.
Yeah, and there's some other things to think about when it comes to chargers as well, even down to does it have a permanent lead attached to it, like this one we've got in front of us here, and how long that lead is. And I think we've made a video that takes people through all those things to sort of think about, Gary, haven't we?
Yeah, so when we start talking about tethered, untethered, the intake position, a consumer unit, and that, these words might not be that commonplace to you, so please check out the video in the link in the description below where we run through all those considerations before having an EV charging point installed.
Yeah, but the next biggest impact on the cost is actually where you want the charger installed, or where it's possible to install it. And what sort of things are we thinking about there, Gary?
Yeah, you know, you've got lots of considerations. So it's going to be on the outside of the building. It could be inside a garage. How far away is it from where you've got your, you might call it a fuse box? What's that distance look like? Because that's going to make it considerably dearer the further it's away. And the installation that we did, we had one 30 meters away, and we put that one to the test. So that's going to obviously change the price as well.
Yeah, I mean, you could have to go through, you know, dig up your garden, go underpaths, you know, route through the floors under your house. Obviously, more time on site for the electrician means you're going to end up paying more for the charger. And then what's the next thing we think about, Gary?
Once we've done that, the suitability of the supply. So that means going to where your metering equipment is. And there's lots of considerations there. Not only the size of the incoming fuse, could be 60, 80, 100 amps, and that could make a difference. But we also explored in another video looking at things called loop supplies. And that's a real hot potato if you've got one of those, isn't it, Gordon?
Yeah, so that's the supply coming into your house. There's not much your electrician or your installer can do about that, but there is a lot of time goes into managing that process if you need to have your supply corrected or upgraded. But then the next thing to think about is the wiring of your house itself. You know, you may, even if you've got a relatively modern house, you may be surprised to find that it's not suitable for the installation of an EV charger, Gary, is that right?
Yeah, so that means all of a sudden then what you're calling your fuse box, which is a consumer unit, might need to be replaced. And that's quite an expensive job in order to do it. If you've got an older property, it might be that your wiring system isn't up to the latest standards and could do with maybe a rewire or upgrading. And we've done some videos on that, on does my house need a rewire? And that will give you again some really good visual clues about the age and the condition of your installation.
Yeah, so if, you know, so the location and the suitability of the supply, again, add up to significant costs if they need to be corrected before you do it, which then leads on to who should install my charge point. Now, the price you quoted there was from PodPoint, and they naturally have to get that market-leading price out there. They have some specific terms and conditions, and I've pulled them up, and they sort of underline what we've just gone through. So the first thing to think about, how far can it be from the meter?
Yeah, so 14, 15 meters they're suggesting, and they're liking it from their description to say it's possibly clipped to the outside of the building, and they will consider whether they would lift floorboards, rooted through ceilings, climb into roof spaces, but that starts now becoming, maybe it's going to cost more. And they use the words, you know, they may have to stop, mightn't they?
Yeah, there's a lot of conditions in there like that. So what's included? The 15 meters of cable, routing the cable through a drilled wall up to 500 millimeters wide.
Yeah, and your walls at home are a meter wide, so yeah. You get halfway through and stop.
Well, yeah. I'm out, or perhaps they just don't carry long drill bits on the van. An additional three-way consumer unit if required.
Which is good. I think that's a good one. So if your consumer unit is full and there is no fuses or circuit breakers that are spare in there, they will install an additional consumer unit.
Yeah, and then an installation of a type A RCD is quite important. We've got separate videos on that. We're not going into that here. And up to 3 meters of plastic conduit to conceal the interior wiring. So I suggest they only carry one length on the van as well.
Yeah, so that's okay for me. That's going to be not necessarily a rare job, but it's going to be the ones that if you're an electrical contractor, you think, oh, I've had a bit of luck. The stuff's all in the right place.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. That's the, almost flies out the van and installs itself price. And then obviously it can't be above 6 feet above the ground.
Okay, so won't use a pair of steps then?
So won't use a pair of steps, yeah. And then there's lots of other things that can obviously cause that price to increase. And the reason we sort of go into that is because we get a lot of questions from eFIXX viewers where they've possibly had their charger bundled into the price of a car.
Yes.
Yeah. So they've actually purchased the charger along with the car. Yeah. And then it's only when you get further down the road of actual installation that suddenly all these additional costs come in.
Yeah, and that's a surprise, isn't it? All of a sudden, you know, and the loop supply has been in there as well. All of a sudden it's a lot further away. There's loads of things that can stop the install of the EV charger. The problem is your car's still gonna come and therefore you won't be able to charge it necessarily on arrival. So this is where there's that sort of balancing act. Do you go with the very good deal that I found on Google using PodPoint, or do you maybe sort out a local electrician that's familiar with the house or the houses on your estate and can obviously offer you not only advice about your EV charging point, but maybe about the condition and upgrading your own wiring systems?
Yeah, you're right, Gary. So yeah, a lot of these nationwide installers who've geared up just to do EV installers fast, you know, probably don't carry the equipment. Or you say it is that knowledge of local properties in the area to be able to, you know, be on site for a long time to do that installation. And just for some context here, included in that standard installation, they expect to be able to get it done in 2 hours.
Wow.
And
peel that again. If they're installing the consumer unit, it was 15 meters away, it was clipped to the outside of the building. I think that would be an incredibly fast time. If it's one person, you might be able to get away with it too, but that's incredibly quick.
Yeah, so as I said, hopefully this has helped you when you're obviously trying to choose which EV charger to purchase and how you're gonna do it. But do check out that other video with the things you could consider, because there's one thing we always talk about when it comes to EV charger installation, that's future-proofing. You know, today you may be thinking we're having one EV car, but there's a lot of two car families and more out there. What's going to happen when you get more cars? What's going to happen when you put solar panels on the roof? A little bit more investment up front now can mitigate some further costs down the road.
As always, it's your feedback and comments that will drive future videos. Is this something that you think, oh, I'm so pleased it's come along, I was considering maybe going for this option, I've looked at my installation, the other videos were left in the description, and you understand now it's going to be a more expensive and more onerous job? Please leave those comments below, and we'll try and get back to as many as we can.